next speaker is Nicole van Gemert. Nicole lives in the Netherlands. She's a former member of the Dutch Parliament, and she is the director of Bund voor Dieren, which means fur for animals, in the Netherlands. This organization is a world leader in the scientific research on the environmental impact of fur farms. Nicole is largely responsible for the ban on fur farms in the Netherlands. She's currently working closely with various Chinese animal rights groups. Welcome.
Thank you very much. So nice to be here. Thank you very much for your invitation to be here on Rosa, but I don't see her right now. But thank you so much to have the opportunity to speak to you all. It was a very inspiring day until now, so I hope you're still a little bit enthusiastic to and motivated to listen to what I have to say, because my main message for this speech is that although I'm from a very, very small country and the distance from my apartment to this venue is more than the whole distance of the Netherlands in time, I really want to show you that a very small organization and a very small country can have a huge impact on animal welfare, and that's my main message. So I was just saying that I thought I would hand my presentation myself, so just go on until the whole sheet is full of text, if you understand what I mean. Because, yeah, otherwise I keep on saying like, okay, so I'm from Bond voor Dieren, and Bond voor Dieren, the name is Dutch, of course, and it's a little play with words, because Bond in the Netherlands means fur, but Bond in the Netherlands also means union. So if you translate it, it says union for animals, and at the same time, fur for animals, and it's the same sentence. So that's why we're called that way. We weren't always called Bond voor Dieren. It used to be the anti-fur coalition, but about 30 years ago, we realized that to be anti-fur is not such a strong message as to be fur-free. So we try in all our communication to be fur-free, except instead of being only anti-fur. So we were founded by three animal welfare organizations in the Netherlands because of the seal hunt in Canada. And people in the Netherlands were so shocked that we needed a special organization only for fur. And we all know about the seal puppies being red, covered in blood, and the beautiful eyes, and lots of people were donating money, and everyone was like, oh, we should wear fur, fur is terrible. I'm talking about the 80s now. And we had these big supermodels going on, like, I'd rather go naked than wear fur. Now, right now, they're wearing more fur than ever. But anyway, so the frustrating thing for our organization was the fact that in the Netherlands, we were producers of mink, foxes, and chinchilla furs. And everyone was upset about the seals, and nobody took any interest in struggling for fur farming animals in the Netherlands. I also think one of the main reasons is the fact that, for example, if a mink looks you in the eye, it doesn't look as cute as a seal or as a rabbit, you know. So it's very difficult to organize people on fur farming animals in the Netherlands. Anyway, so we exist for about 30 years, and we are a small NGO. We are totally dependent on donations of people, so we don't get any money from the state or big funds. And Mark talked earlier about fundraising and how I'm not very good at that. I realized that in America, the fundraising is almost like a machine in here. It's so professional, and your country is like so organized when it comes to fundraising. And well, at least in the Netherlands or other European countries, we don't have that at all. It's very difficult to struggle. But some things have become more and more easy, and that's social media, that's free publicity, that's free press. So we have a lot of means to spread our message, also without any funding. So we have different ways of achieving our goals. Let me just take this one in my hand. So what we do, a lot of our work is lobbying. We lobby on a national level, of course, also on a European level and on an international level. And we try to approach the fur issue from all sides. So lobby on one hand, for the policymakers and politicians. On the other hand, we try to make fashion brands, top designers, but also like normal stores to go for free. Education is one of our main goals at Ontwerpieren. We go to schools, teach children compassion, have campaigns on compassion and animals. And of course, we try to get in the media like all the time. And the bad thing for that is that mostly it's not the message, but the means, how you get in the media. And sometimes it's really frustrating. Sometimes we have very good ideas, but we need a celebrity to support it. Otherwise, nobody will bring you news. And for me, sometimes, and also when I look at you all, you're probably all working very hard on animal welfare, but you always need some celebrities to be at this event, for example, today, to draw the public or to speak out for you. And I myself really think that's quite frustrating sometimes. Next slide, please. Ontwerpieren is a member of the Dutch Animal Welfare Coalition. It's a quite unique coalition of almost all animal welfare organizations in the Netherlands. They come together, and sometimes when it's an animal welfare matter of high importance, we set aside our differences, we set aside our fundraising, and we go for this goal. So fur farming was one. Of course, the campaign was ours, but everyone supported us. For example, the religious, sorry, my English is not always that sharp at the end of the day, but religion slaughter, yeah? So then every organization comes together, and that's the coalition. On the other hand, we are a member of the Furfree Alliance, just like Mark, who was speaking earlier today. And the Furfree Alliance is quite a unique organization. We are growing almost every month now, mostly Eastern European countries, because the fur issue is a huge problem there. And we have organizations in America, in China, in almost every European country. Twice a year we come together, and it's mostly knowledge. We exchange knowledge with each other, but also once a year we decide in March on a new top design brands to go for free, and we start a campaign on that one. So it's always in the deepest secret that we start the campaign, but the problem is our success, actually, because every time when we decide which brand this year will be the target, the brand goes for free before we can start our campaign. Yeah. So this time we decided on Prada. We launched our big Prada campaign just 1 month, no, 2 weeks ago. And we were really standing ready, like, okay, if Prada goes for free now, we have to be ready, but they don't. But I really think we will succeed in this campaign. It's the first campaign that all the organizations throughout the whole world are doing together. Everyone is calling local Prada offices in their country. So we put the phone number of the offices of Prada in every country, the national number, and we're all emailing and targeting them. So maybe if I'm invited like next year, I'll talk about a lot of a fashion brand, because Prada will definitely go free. So anyway, this is my introduction. So the animals that we are working on is, of course, mink farming, foxes and chinchillas. Then we have the seal hunting in Canada. And I don't know how many people of you know about the seal hunting in Namibia, because it's even bigger than the seal hunt in Canada. And that's even worse. And Ontwerpieren has a long history in campaigning against the seal hunt in Namibia. And it's the hardest campaign we've ever done, that we're still doing, because it's just not possible to organize people to work on this hunt. It's a hidden hunt. It's about 65,000 seals a year that are killed on the beaches of Namibia. We've sent an undercover team there twice. Once it was arrested, the second time we managed to get about 30 seconds of footage of this terrible, terrible hunt in Namibia. But it's difficult, because you can't ask for boycott for Namibia or something, because it's a developing country. So it's very hard to find a way to get attention for these seals. And also, in my personal opinion, it's the seals in Namibia are brown, and the seals in Canada are white with the puppy eyes. So it's always a matter of sexiness of an animal, and that's sad to conclude, but it's really, really true. Anyway, we don't give up, we go on, but that's not where my presentation is about. Of course, we have the dogs, cats, raccoon dogs imported from China. So those are the main subjects we are working on. To be clear, Bolsvee is only working on the fur issue. Also a little bit on other animals in textile. Lots of people have no think that if you use wool, it's okay, or if you have silk, it's okay. So we're trying to educate people on other things and down. For example, I'm from the opinion that there is no responsible down whatsoever. I've never seen any down that is animal friendly, but that's also another discussion. But so that's where we are working on. And then, of course, the fashion side, we have a big record on our environmental work. We did a lot of research on the environmental effects of fur. But Kimberly will speak about those later, so that gives me more chance to talk about other campaigns. And of course, like I said, education. So this is the Furfury Retailer Program. I don't know if you know about it. The Furfury Alliance has its own Furfury Retailer Program. It's a beautiful website. You see a picture on the left side. You can look up every shop you want and see if it's fur-free. And it's not just that we concluded that a shop is fur-free. What we did is they signed a contract stating that they will never ever have or use fur, also not in the advertisements as well. So it's not just a list. And then also we have the Dutch one. It's called the Bondsvrijlijst, the fur-free list in the Netherlands. And that's for especially for smaller shops and little boutiques. What we do in the Furfury Alliance, the country where the shop is located will lead the campaign. So we do Dutch campaigns against Dutch brands. For example, the Zara is being targeted by Spain. And so that's how we divide the different campaigns. And then, of course, like I told before, once a year we have a big fashion house that we do all together. And the first one was Hugo Boss, I guess. I'm looking at my direction, but I think it's Hugo Boss was the first one that we tried. But also, yeah, he went for free. So look it up if you're interested. It's a very interesting website. It's furfreeretailer.com. Next, please. Just some images of our campaigns, just to brag a little bit about what we've done with just a few people. On the left side beneath, it's really nice. It's I don't know if you know clean graffiti, when you have water and you put it on the floor in front of shops. People are looking like, we made some kind of, is it an English word, parody? A joke about the fact that we are always accused of terrorism and accused of putting paint on jackets and stuff. So we decided to clean the street. So this thing, this iron thing, we had this high pressure water hose, and I really don't know how to say it in English, but we cleaned the street through this mall, and it says only animals wear fur. And we went to every fur shop in the nice streets, and we put this plate on the ground, and we cleaned the streets, and so only the letters were clean, and the rest were still dirty, and you can't get it off. The shop owner can't get it off. So immediately the police came, and I didn't have this workshop that we had today, so I was like, I'm never silent. So I immediately started a discussion that we were cleaning the streets. We didn't vandalize anything. We didn't do anything wrong. It's just water. And they were like, oh. And then we went to different towns, and buses came with police officers, and like, what are you doing, those scary activists? But because we were cleaning and only using water, they couldn't do anything to us. But the whole street was full of only animals wear fur in front of every shop that bought. That's the whole fur. You see it on the right, on top. And then on the right side, this is a very famous Dutch actress, and she says, there's more to your fur coat than you know. So it's the inside of an animal around her neck, and it was very impressive to the public because she's really popular. And we realized when we started our public campaigns that we kind of forgot to explain to people, to the younger people, that the fur that they're wearing is real. And that's a mistake we made in the first years when the trims were coming back, like 10 years ago or something. We were like, oh, look at this, it's terrible, and animals are suffering. And yoga people in the street would say, I'm not wearing animals. No, this is fake, you know, or no, this is not my coat, or it was cheap. We hear it a lot, it was cheap, it was only $40, so how can it be real fur? So what we needed to do was to educate first, to tell younger people, this is fur, this is real. We had an investigation on the street. We asked 500 young people, what are you wearing? Is it real or not real? And one out of three had no idea that the fur that they were wearing was real. And then the next question was, what animal is it? And it was about 80% of the younger people had no idea which animal. We heard the craziest animals. So, and then when they realized that not only they are wearing a real animal, but also that they had no idea which animal, it made them realize, okay, this is stupid behavior. So for me, it works better than just shout, you know, fur is murder, and get off that goat and stuff like that. Just especially people with dogs, let them realize that they're walking with a dog and carrying a dog, and that's really, really effective. Thank you. Yeah, now, this was an introduction, because I was asked to speak about fur farming. We started a campaign on fur farming like 35 years ago in the Netherlands, and we did everything we could. We organized the night of the meet, we went to politicians, we had even cookies made for politicians, all kinds of means to campaign this ban next year, please. Yeah. Okay, so fur farming, why are we against fur farming? First of all, the minks, the foxes and the chinchillas used for fur, also coyotes for trapping, of course, are wild animals. They are not supposed to be kept in cages. And of course, I mean, we probably all agree here that you should not keep any animal in cages and kill it. But if you look at behavior, don't get me wrong, but if you look at behavior, a chicken, a cow, a pig, you can keep them in a cage. Don't talk about what kind of cage or whatever. Wild animals get absolutely crazy. So that's the main argument against fur. And they are also solitary living animals. And we saw that with the terrible footage that I didn't see actually, because I was looking down. But you see when minks get into cages, especially with other minks, they get absolutely crazy. Then, of course, it's a luxury product with lots of alternatives. I don't issue, of course, why fur is terrible. But what is quite unique in the Netherlands is that our ban, because we have a ban, I'm now saying the plot of my story, of course, but you already knew, it's based on ethics. And it's based on ethics from all these reasons that are stated here. Next sheet, please. Yeah. We can change the, no, it's fine, the environmental, yeah, we did a lot of environmental research. On mink. Please stay today because there will be a very interesting lecture on that. But what's really interesting, we had a research independently, so not by us. It seemed that the climate impact of 1 kilo of mink fur is approximately 5 times higher than any other form of textile. So that's really interesting. And the other interesting thing is that one mink needs about 365 kilos of feed in his life. So, for a kilo fur, sorry, it's all there. That was a very important argument we thought in the Dutch mink ban and the process of the Dutch mink ban, but it wasn't. Actually, politics didn't really care about the environmental effects because for them it was much more important. And this report that we had made, it was put in a drawer and we never looked at it again until now. And as you have heard today, the environmental argument is totally coming back. But by that time, the environmental argument was nothing. Another interesting study we did last year, no, 2 years ago, together with the European Alliance, is the toxic, that word I can't pronounce in English, the effect that drinks are toxic. And we had the research done. It was done in Italy earlier, and now we combined all the countries together. And it seems that a freight train 15 times more toxic is more 15 times more toxic than allowed in the European Union. And for lots and lots and lots of people, that was a very important argument. It was very interesting to see how much media we got. I was in like every news show, and then I was like, oh my gosh, it's toxic, oh my gosh. And then our own supporters were really angry with us, like, you're not speaking about animal welfare, that's much worse than you let the children die, you know, those kind of reactions of social media, of course. But it, for us, it doesn't count, because every argument I can use against this fur industry, I'll use and exaggerate it and use it again. So, yeah, that's the issue. Yeah, then I want to say something about the Dutch name ban. And it's important, this sheet, to show you that, can you go on there? Yeah, to show you how long it takes. How long it takes to get a ban. You know, we started in 1959, and in 2030 we have a ban with transition period until 2024. So we're not there yet. And lots of things can happen. We can have a new government, we can have like some Trump kind of person ruling in the Netherlands, we can have a Nexit and leave the European Union. Lots of things can happen, so we're not there. But, and I want to stress that, because you talked about it earlier, I haven't really seen any initiatives or activists in the United States until now working on fur ban. And maybe I'm totally wrong, but I have the feeling that I kind of know around the world who's working on fur bans and who's organizing for fur bans. And the Netherlands are the third biggest exporter of mink fur in the world. We have 6 million mink with only 150 farms. So you can't call it farms, you have to call it factories, of course. But anyway, so, but America has 3.5 million mink. So you can, like, I love it that California is going for free, but it's also a little bit hypocrite. If you're producing on such a huge scale, then you are banning the import or start to work on the import. That's a choice we in the Netherlands didn't make. We never asked for a ban on import of fur because we were like, okay, we are producing. So quit the production and then start blaming other countries. And that's a thing that I think America should do. And especially since I know that there are many, many Dutch mink breeders moving to America now and starting here because there are no protests, there are no regulations, hardly any regulations. There are regulations, but not very much. But especially the political climate and the fact that like in the Netherlands, everything's close to each other, but in America, it's far away. You wouldn't notice a mink farm if you drive. I drove through America last year for holiday, and there are places where you don't meet anyone. So if you put a fur farm there, who would know? So it would be really, really interesting, and I would really like to help activists here with the Hope for Free Alliance, of course, to help you to start, maybe I'm wrong, I can hear it if there's time left in my speech, I hope to hear it from you. I haven't been contacted with any American activists for fur breeding, only the popular low-hanging fruit, that's how I call it. And don't get me wrong, you are much further on many, many other animal welfare issues than we are, so I'm not blaming at all. But it seems like 3.5 million, when you get 3.5 million meats banned in the United States, imagine what a signal that would be to the fur industry. But now I stop lecturing you. Can you go one back? Because I just need to know if I should tell something about it. Yeah, because we had this start of the discussion, and what was really interesting is that in 2008, the foxes and chinchillas were banned in the Netherlands based on welfare. And it was very obvious for all the politicians that the welfare standards were terrible for these animals. And there I go again, it's the cuteness of foxes. A fox in a cage is heartbreaking. I mean, even a happy fox in a cage is still looking so. Yeah, you want to rescue. You want to rescue him. Yeah, and a mink in a cage won't even look at you. You are just like panicked and freak out. So, but that also matter the politics, of course. So the foxes and chinchillas, they are really cute. We're back pretty soon. But it was also because it was a very small sector, and there were like four or five fox breeders in the Netherlands, and they just transferred to me. So that's how it went. Then we had this proposal for a mink ban in parliament from a more or less left-wing minister. And then we got the most terrible terrorist action, that one of our, the soon-to-be prime minister was killed in Fortuyn, his name was. And it was the first political murder in the Netherlands ever. And he was murdered by an animal activist who actually worked for us. So he was murdered because he said, as soon as I will become your next president, your prime minister, I will get this ban off the table. And that's why he was killed. So it was really terrible and sad. And we had new elections, of course. And then the Ming ban was from the table, because the whole political climate was against us. You know, everyone who cared for animals were like, okay, it wasn't me, you know, I'm nice. So it was a really difficult time. And then a few years later, I was in parliament, and suddenly realized, when I was on my paper counting votes for some animal welfare thing, I can't remember what it was, I was like, hey, we had new elections, and now we have a majority that cares for animals, almost. So I was like, this is the time. So my party, we filed a new ban. I wrote the ban together with my Fudir, but I didn't work there by that time. And we filed the law. So many different political arenas came and went, but before it was adopted. And it was also really interesting, because you only have two parties, right? You have the Democrats and the Republicans, but we have many. And it was really interesting that the fur issue is not a left-wing or a right-wing subject. And that's really interesting, because, for example, the Christians, the white-wing Christians, really right-wing, voted for the ban, because they said fur is pride, and we shouldn't have it as a pride. And then the Greens said it's bad for the environment, and we have a party of the animals, so the party of the animals said it was bad for the animals. And then it was really, really interesting to see how you could have different arguments for almost every political color to get this ban adopted, and that really opens up lots of perspectives for all of us. And we see it also now in Europe, and this is the next sheet, where the fur bans are rising everywhere. That in every country there's another argument. It's invasive species, like mink don't belong here, for example. In Poland, the main argument is pollution and the health of the people living around it. I went to Bosnia, and there they feel like they should clean up the garbage of Western countries. Like, if the Western doesn't want to have fur farms, why should we? So in every country there's a little a new argument. So this is the list of the bans in Europe right now. And what's unique about the Dutch mink ban is that it's such a great, large sector. So, for example, England, sorry, Mark, it wasn't that big. So it was easier to buy them out, right? Am I right to say that it was easier to buy them out for the government? Yeah.
You were still first.
You were first. England leads the way. No, that's not what I mean, but I mean that it's easier to buy them out. In Ireland, we're really working on Ireland right now, because there was just filed a proposal for a ban, and we have three farms. It must be doable to buy them out. Belgium just had his better ban about half a year ago, something like that, and they're also buying them out. And it's really funny, because Belgium has this transition period until 2023, and they just do it to be 1 year earlier than the Netherlands, because it's always a struggle. It's Belgium and the Netherlands are like Canada and the United States, you know, always fighting each other. But yeah, so that's unique, and especially because the Dutch really like to brag about how we are the best child in the class. That's an expression we use a lot, to be the best in class. And we always do it. We were the first with this and the first with that. But it was always quite easy. Like, for example, we banned animal testing for cosmetics, but we don't have any cosmetic industry. So there was nothing to ban, but we banned it. And we banned circuses with wild animals, and we had one circus with two elephants, and that's it in the whole of the country. So it's always easy to go, oh, we were almost the first to ban seal skin, but we don't have a sealing industry, so it's always easy. So this is the first time that it really, really hurts. It's 6 million minks, it really hurts. So I'm very proud of that. But anyway, we're not there yet. Next, please. Oh yeah, hey, that's a nice bridge too, we're not there yet. Yeah, mission accomplished, no. Because we have almost banned production, we have almost banned all the shops, there's hardly any brand in the Netherlands that still sells fur. We are not there, because then the really, in my opinion, biggest challenge for the coming decennia is China, and all the garbage that's coming from China in the form of fur, the pom-poms, you talked about it quickly, all these accessories that are just slipping in, also in the Netherlands, of course, in every country. And so we decided we need to, when we want to abandon the import of fur in Europe, we need to work with China, because China won't understand. If we just tell China, tell China, that's really funny, like Pompidou tells China to once for the last time, yeah. If we ask China or tell China that we don't want to import their fur, it's, in my opinion, important that China understands why. And animal welfare and the development of animal welfare in China is it's just beginning. It's totally at the beginning, you know, the first people in China are starting to have pets, for example, because even having pets is totally not usual. And we tried different angles. We tried, like, for example, health. The toxic fur research we did was very important because Chinese people are very concerned about their health. But we decided as Bonsfordier that we needed to educate people in China, and that's almost impossible because there live like 1 billion people. And I mean, how to reach them? Social media is not what it is here. If you hang about 10,000 posters everywhere in the subway, it's still nothing. So it's really difficult. I had some figures, and that's another thing, because Mark just said that it's difficult to get figures, the accurate figures, and that's a great problem for almost every NGO involved in fur, that getting the numbers, mostly your sources are the fur industry. If it comes to welfare standards, you know, welfare research is all done by the fur industry. Numbers, statistics, all kinds of transparency that you see with almost every other product. I mean, if you buy a pack of milk, everything is there. But on fur, it's nothing. So these are the numbers that I know of are the most accurate and the most independent. But anyway, you see that China is booming and getting bigger and bigger, and I couldn't find any numbers after 2015. Maybe you have it. So what we decided to do, next sheet, please. I'm in the wrong. We didn't decide anything yet, because I just wanted to ask your attention also for the dogs and cats slaughter in China for fur. And our definition of fur in the Netherlands is that you use only the skin and not the animal, and that's what makes it fur to us, for example. But in the case of dogs and cats, it's different, because they are also eaten in China, and that makes it more difficult to explain to Chinese people, so that it's wrong to kill them, of course, and to the fur argument is not as strong with cats and dogs in China, because you immediately get it back that we are eating cows and we don't mind, and if they are eating dogs, we do mind. It's just that every year we go to Yulin, and I don't know if you heard of it, probably you did. It's a dog meat festival there. We were there just this year again. But there are so many matters of how you say that if you believe in something that is not so, I can't remember the suspicious. I don't know. You know, when the Chinese people believe so much bullshit, that's full of bullshit. about animals and about the strength of animals and the ghosts of animals and the story that a dog should have a lot of adrenaline when it's killed because it's the meat is better. It's really true that they really are convinced about that. And it's just a sidestep, but on Yulin, the Dog Meat Festival, we were there last year, there was a lot of commotion, there were lots of activist groups very, very angry about this festival. Everyone wanted to go there, rescue dogs, and there was a lot of commotion. And it was hardly, it almost disappeared, the whole festival. There were all kinds of regulations, killers and butchers were allowed only to kill three animals or something like that. But this year, it kind of faded away. And there wasn't any media attention at all anymore. And we went again. And there were like five activists in the whole of Yulin. And it was back worse than ever. It was bigger than ever. It was really, really terrible. So, but what it proves to me is that as soon as the Chinese people have the feeling, or the Chinese authorities have the feeling that we are watching, it helps. And if they have the feeling that we care about the animals over there, it really helps this battle. And we should care, because also, I don't know if you have it here, like AliExpress and all those kind of online websites, they're just selling like dog and cat fur in the Netherlands. It's forbidden. But you have all these Chinese, very cheap clothing websites, and I know this is an animal conference, but don't forget the circumstances children are working there on these clothing. Huh? There's a lot of things are going on, and we went undercover to China this year. We saw forbidden species on the markets. We saw Prada labels. We saw Gucci labels on real fur. And now I don't know if Gucci is ordering fur or that the real fur persons are putting Gucci on the jackets. But there's so much going on. There's no authority caring at all. We even went to the police in China with some endangered species in coats, and they couldn't care less. And they asked, they accused us for being spies because we had these undercover gloves. So next sheet, please. What we did? We financed a Chinese website. We actually copied our own website with all the information we have on fur, and we had it translated in Chinese. You can't control it, probably, if I'm not saying the right thing, but yes, we did. We did this together with Act Asia, that's the Chinese animal welfare organization. And we work with a lot of Chinese animal welfare organizations. Everyone wants to work with us because, for example, social media is something for us very difficult to understand, that you need local people to do something. So that's what it is. And then, of course, also in the Netherlands, the picture on the right side is our campaign for the embassy, the Chinese embassy. Actually, we had our seal hunt in Canada campaign from last year was totally part of the China, because we found out that the whole seal skin collection in Canada is being sold to one person in China, and he's buying all skin first. So we thought, well, if we can have an import ban in China, then we resolve the problem in Canada, because Canada won't listen to us. Yeah, I don't know if you've ever seen these pictures of Trudeau with like kilos of fur on his shoulder. But, well, she never did listen to us either, so that's a little bit of a shame. But we think with the seal hunt, if we can tell China that the whole world, almost the whole world, except for a certain part of Russia, have an import ban on seal skin, and only China hasn't, maybe we'll convince them. So, then what we did was we started a crowdfunding. First we had a crowdfunding for the website, and we gained the money for the website. And then we had a crowdfunding last year for a documentary on China. And of course there are many images of the Chinese fur industry. We probably all know the raccoon dog being skinned alive. I never forget that image ever. But my feeling is that there are so many absolutely horrific images, like the ones Mark showed earlier, of the fur industry, that people look away. And I'm an animal activist and I look away. So we are trying to make a different movie. We're trying to make a movie that takes the viewer on the road and no terrible images, just the despair of the animals is enough. If an animal looks at you from its cage, mostly it's enough, in my opinion. And people will watch the documentary until the end, and that's what we're hoping for. So we gained, with our crowdfunding, we gained 17,000 euros, so that's a tremendous amount of money for our organization, because our whole campaign budget is 5,000 euros a year. So for us, we never had so much money. So we went to China and made undercover footage, but we're not done yet because we need more. And we're going back, but we're starting crowdfunding again. But I was hoping to show you a sneak preview of the movie, and maybe if one of your organizations is interested, I can send you, ask me and I'll send you the movie when it's finished, because what we experience, especially from the big campaigns from PETA, is as soon as you people see things with their own eyes, they start rejecting being a part of it. Can you try to put this movie on? But anyway, so my next sheet was going to be big frogs looking at you and asking for questions. So I was wondering if there are any questions before we see this sneak preview, because I try to be as short as possible to have room for a discussion. Kimberly.
Understanding you say that you were a member of the Animal Party, is that a separate like organization, or what are the
No, in the Netherlands, the question was if I was a member of the Animal Party. I wasn't. When I was in the parliament, there wasn't an Animal Party yet. I'm a member of the Socialist Party. but we have about 15 political parties in parliament, so the whole spectrum from totally to the left to totally to the right, and the Christians and the Greens, and we form coalitions together. So, yeah.
You said that you bought out the farms. You bought them out. What do you mean by that?
No, we didn't bought them out. In England, they were bought out. In the Netherlands, you know, you have these European rules for fair trade and level playing fields and stuff like that. And state support. So in the Netherlands, we could, everyone who wants to benefit from the euro can choose. Either you compensate financially, or you give a transition period to earn back all the investments. And we chose for a transition period, because buying this one out was just absolutely not possible in the Netherlands. It's way too big. It would be like 1 billion euros or something.
You'd be buying out and transferring the apples somewhere else?
Oh, well, buying out, sorry, maybe it's not correct English, it's pay them to stop. Yeah, pay them to stop. And what we did in the Netherlands, we are paying for the cages. So in 2024, when the farmer stops, he gets money for the demolition of the cages, because we didn't want the cages to go to other countries. So that's what we did. So we had that before. We banned some terrible fishery, and the boats just went to Mauritania or whatever country it was. So we are trying to stop them from going to other countries, but of course it doesn't work, because they are going. And that was like the main argument of the fur industry against our ban was, bont voor dieren is the worst for animal welfare in the world, because of bont voor dieren, all these minks that live in beautiful circumstances with classical music and being kittled to death in the Netherlands have to go to countries where the suffering will be unbearable for them, and that's your fault, animal activists. So that was really their argument. And then, but we were so lucky that, like, after 1 month after we had our ban, Slovenia decided for a ban. So we said, no, it's the ban that's moving to other countries and not the mink. And that was really a very strong argument. And it is true, there are lots of states, countries are looking at the Netherlands like, is it all right? What does the higher church say? Because the mink breeders went to the European court, and they lost everything. So we are allowed to do this. And as soon as the judge said, okay, Netherlands, you don't have to pay any compensation, and it's all right what you're doing on edible grounds, all the other countries are following. Yeah? Yeah.
You want to play it?
Yes. Give me 1 minute. Oh, we have, don't have sound, I'm sorry.
Thomas set up a fake company as a front to contact food suppliers and food farms.
So we had to find a way to get the footage very discreetly.
No way you can see this is a camera.
You can do an order for 1,500 in a week. Does it come over here?
Yeah.
The animal welfare conditions are horrific.
Some say, oh no, if the leg is broken, we just cut it off. The guy just said animals are protected, so we may have issues with customs.
Life has no value, and we really, really should be tolerant of this.
Yeah, what I forgot to say is that we started a company. We started a company in luxury goods in England, and we have a CEO and a staff, and everything is perfect on paper. And so the CEO and his secretary went to China. So that was a cover. And it's still a cover because we are going back next month when the killing season starts. So what I want to explain is that we are, that's why all the doors open, because we are traders in fur there. So that's a little very short sneak preview of what's coming. So if you're interested, please let me know afterwards. Are there any more questions?
What happened to the animal rights activists who killed the pro-animal prime minister candidate? What happened?
Yeah, he went to jail. He was actually just released like 1 month ago or something. So yeah, he went to jail. And he's like a persona non grata in the Netherlands. So he wants to immigrate to another country, but his parole also on the green. Anyways, the right-wing politicians are all the time using him as an example. And it has been 15, 20 years ago now. Yeah.
Okay. So I'm wondering what type of strategy you would use against a large company like Anna, whose wholesaling point is using real fur and using an animal that's considered a pest in most places. You know, that has incredible market power to the stores, I'm not sure how you would approach that.
Change the image. Change the status of the fur. I think it's the only way. We have Canada Goose is like immensely popular in the Netherlands right now, really immensely popular. I don't understand where these kids get the money, because they cost about 900 euros or something. But anyway, we had a similar company as Canada Goose in the Netherlands, and they are for free now, because we reduced them to secondhand jackets nobody wants to wear. You know, it's secondhand because it's already been from another animal. So it's, in my opinion, on social, targeting, tagging them in everything, and change this luxury brand into a brand nobody wants to wear. Use celebrities and stuff like that. Because I was in somewhere, I can't remember, I think it was London, where I saw some protesters in front of the Canada Goose shop. They were standing there with these signs with terrible pictures. And I don't think Canada Goose couldn't give less about that. The only thing is to change their image and make them a brand nobody wants to be seen with. And it's very difficult with Canada Goose. But on the other hand, I've seen those brands come and go. You know, we had these few terrible enemies in the Netherlands with brands, and then suddenly they are not popular anymore. And in the case of Canada Goose, show these movies to everyone who wants to see them, but make them ridiculous, because they don't want to be ridiculous. And you have to make sure that people who are wearing the jacket are regarded by the surroundings as ridiculous. And that's what we do in schools, to make sure that the boys with the trim coats are not the cool guys, but they are the losers. And it works with education. But Canada Goose is a difficult one, but I'm absolutely sure with the fashion and the speed of fashion that in like 2 years, it's like, oh, been there, done that. You know, Canada Goose is so 2018. That's what I hope and that's what I think, actually, because it's all the same jacket. So in 2 years' time, you're too late to wear that jacket, probably, according to the fashion rules. But protesting in front of the door, I don't think Canada Goose cares at all because they have had so much shit. But maybe it's a good one for the Perfume Alliance to combine everyone. Yeah. No, okay, thank you.